I'm Kyra. Welcome to Above the Bar,
where every week we take on some current events for conversations and libations with a legal twist.
So about 4 or 5 years ago, we conquered the bar. And so now we're above the bar, having and sharing our favorite cocktails from behind the bar. So this week, we're down in Houston, and we've been tackling Hurricane Harvey. So can you guess what our cocktail?
Drum roll.
You probably guessed it. Hurricanes.
Hurricanes. We're demolishing hurricanes here in Houston.
Cheers. Cheers.
So if you want our delicious recipe. For our recipes for our cocktails, our libations every week, make sure to follow us on Instagram. You can go to
Above the Bar PC on Instagram, or
you can go to our website at abovethebar.live, because we are live, so it's easy to remember, abovethebar.live, and check out the recipes. So every week you can share with us as we share with you.
And if there is a recipe or a particular alcohol that you would like to know a recipe for, feel free to drop us a line and let us know, and we'll do some
research for you
and see what we can pull out the hat for you.
Absolutely. So what's on the menu tonight? We're going
to
talk
about. So tonight we're really here to help those who have been impacted by Hurricane Harvey. And we want to give some resources and some information regarding a lot of the buzz that has been going around regarding the new House Bill 1774, policies, insurance policies, employment rights, and also address the impact to small businesses. That's something that's kind of, I haven't heard too much about, but it's definitely going to be.
It's
going to
come down the line.
Yeah, exactly.
And Hurricane Harvey has been such a surprise. I think the impact has been so devastating. I think people forget that Houston is ginormous. It is
crazy.
You know, the size, when I look at the population counts, is the size of probably 8 small states put together.
That's crazy.
It is humongous. So to have this extent of loss, you know, it's really sad and disheartening. And I think the nation is at attention to what's happening here in Houston. But on the bright side, we have some tremendous stories of strength and neighborly love and survival.
It's been some true hometown heroes that really just stepped up to the plate. And my hats go off to those who have risked their own lives to help others.
Yeah.
It's really been a heartfelt response.
Yeah,
all across the
nation. And so we're so proud, but we also want to remind people that they can participate. You may be in Houston, don't know what to do. You may not be in Houston, still don't know what to do, but there are tons of resources. We'll put some of them on our website for you to kind of help out the Houston residents and the Houston community during this difficult time. And this is certainly not the $25,000 call out. I'm no Kevin Hart, right? I don't know anybody with an extra $25,000 in that bank account. But it's more like a Michael Blackson call out.
Got that $10 holla.
Got that $10 holla. $16 respect, no respect. Send it.
That was hilarious.
And you have to follow him to catch that. But it's worth the follow. It's hilarious. But there's a million things you can do, even if it's just going through your closet and donating some old clothes and having it shipped down. I know there's some drives and Atlanta. I've seen drives in Atlanta and Chicago. So there's a way to participate. You can always donate money to the cause, to any of the worthy causes. So let's hop into this bill, because I think a lot of people are scared. They're worried. They lost, you know, very sentimental pieces of property or severe damage to their homes, and they don't know what to do. And there is this big old rumor going around that the new bill that goes in acts on Friday, September 1st, will prevent them from filing a claim successfully. So let's talk about it. Kyra, what's up with that?
And what they money? So we are referencing House Bill 1774. And this bill is a new bill that goes into effect on Friday, September 1st. This bill does not impact you being able to file a claim. Let me say that again. It does not impact you being able to file a claim. You can file a claim after the first for any damage that you have to your home. Please do not by any means put yourself in a dangerous situation, trying to get paperwork together, going into your home if it's not safe, to retrieve paperwork, or leaving your home if it's not safe. Just stay put. You can file a claim after the first. The bill primarily addresses lawsuits.
Yeah.
If you if you file a claim and your insurance provider does not respond timely, and or they do not pay what you think is sufficient amount for what your quote and what you provided to be repaired. So, with that being the case, you file on time. I just want to repeat this because a lot of people have been like, oh, I gotta go file. There's been a lot of misinformation out there. Even I got called out and I was like, hold on.
Yes, people like, wrong. You especially other attorneys.
File whenever you can. There is not a deadline as to filing by Friday. However, if you were to sue because, let's say, your insurance provider taking forever to pay, or you quote them for, let's say, $25,000 and they only want to pay $10,000, and you file a lawsuit against them because you have a discrepancy, that is where the bill comes into effect. So some new rules are that you will have to provide them with pre-suit notice, meaning that you have to provide them with 60 days to remedy the issue before you can actually file the lawsuit.
And I think that's pretty common. When you file a suit, you have to give
against
notice.
Anyone.
Yeah, you have to give them an ability to make repairs. And it's I think it's more of a thing about clogging the system for claims that could have been remedied before the time frame.
And also, in addition to that, they were having an issue with frivolous claims.
Yeah.
And people kind of filing a lawsuit before they even filed their insurance claim. So it was really, the purpose of it is to kind of remedy clogging the system with these frivolous lawsuits against insurance providers and not providing them the time to remedy the situation.
Well, that sounds all well and good, but I mean, from what I've read, and I'm not an expert on it, but
there's pros and cons.
Yeah, I definitely think there are some parts to it that people should kind of be aware of, because I definitely know that it changes that the interest rate that they have to pay on what they have left unpaid. So let's say you sue them for $50,000, and through whatever time frame, the judge determines you owe that $50,000. So you are due interest from the time that they should have paid.
Right, exactly. So as like, let's say you filed the claim today or Thursday before the 1st, if you were to sue the insurance provider, then you would get 18% of a penalty fee on top of what you were due. Now, if you do it after the 1st, you still get a penalty fee. It's just that it's lessened to 10%. And so some people are like, well, that doesn't hold the, you know, that does not as strong of a penalty. Where's the accountability to the insurance provider and things like that? It's still there.
Yeah.
It's just not that high of a rate. And another thing that's kind of off-putting a little bit is that, and I guess it's going back to the frivolous claims, if you file a claim and you sue and they do not find your estimate to be 80% or more accurate, you cannot recover your attorney fees. Or you may not be able to recover all of your attorney fees.
That's scary. Attorneys are expensive.
Yes. I have the most payback. I'm just
it's for a reason. It's not
but that's neither here nor there. But that's just something to be aware of. And so I think that goes back to the frivolousness and making sure that if you're filing a claim, that it is an accurate claim and you're just not trying to get money just because, you know, the situation.
That makes it so scary because, unfortunately, not everybody takes, I mean, there are people definitely trying to take advantage of these situations.
Yeah.
And so you may be trusting a contractor who tells you your repair should cost $100,000, and then you file a claim and those repairs are more accurately $50,000. Now you can't get attorney's fees. So I would say definitely make sure that you do some research on your contractors, even in this tough time, because I know they're going to be in demand and probably adding to their cost a little bit, because they can pick and choose their jobs. But there are a lot of great contractors out there, and there are a lot of contractors, I think, that are coming from other states, understanding that people are in, you know, desperate need right now. So make sure you take some time to research your contractor. Just a note that I've learned in my own experience. Oh, and let me just, an aside, this is not legal advice. We just kind of have to tell you that.
Yes.
You have to talk to an attorney. This is just some legal discussion.
You can hire us as your attorney.
Yes. But this is not legal advice. No. We're not
your attorney.
No. We love you, though. So, you know, just making sure that it's a good contractor. And like I said, from personal experience, because I do have rental properties, if they're asking for everything up front, no. Some things awry. You might pay yourself for materials, but do not pay someone labor fees all up front.
Yeah.
Just not a good idea. Very hard to get your money back. And then you're out of money, and if insurance company doesn't pay, then you're double out of money, and it can be a scary situation. So, you know, be wise, and if you have any questions, there are certainly resources where you can get information about contractors. Certainly, if nothing else, see if they have any suits.
Yeah.
And somebody has sued them and is already disgruntled.
And maybe get more than one quote. And yeah, don't just trust one contractor. Check out two or three and get a quote. And that way you can see if someone is way off the margin or if they're all pretty much within the same, you know, dollars.
Yeah. So, you know, part of that is to people understanding the process. Because I think most people will avoid the lawsuit stage. Mm-hmm. I mean, because it's very expensive. To file a lawsuit. And most of the time, people honestly just want their property fixed. They can't go for years or pay out of pocket for these major repairs. I mean, you're talking about a house that's been flooded in 3 feet mm-hmm. of water, so all the floors have to be redone. All of your furniture.
There's a roof that's leaking. You cannot wait for that to be. One thing I do want to point out, though, that I did not say that I should have in the beginning, is that this applies to people who have flood insurance through private companies.
Oh!
Which is a big difference. That's and your tricky. Private companies are Geico, State Farm, all of those type of companies, versus if you have a flood insurance policy through the government.
Okay, because through FEMA.
Through mm-hmm. FEMA, because this is a state-regulated legislative law. This is not federal, so it will only apply to private companies. It will not apply to the government if that's who you're interacting with to get your flood damage covered through.
And you know what? That brings up a good point because I think, you know, sometimes insurance policies, and I think we're all guilty, they just go as some, like, unread piece of papers that you leave in the corner. you say, I want
Nobody
insurance.
Nobody really reads it.
Yeah, you call your agent, I want insurance, and you either say, I want lots. Or they give you the quote for that, and you're like, that's too much. Or what's the next best?
Or you like start reading it while you have something to drink.
You put your drink on it, and it gets the water spot, and then you say, oh, well, I can't read that part. So let's talk about what the difference is. What are people filing? I mean, I know that some people think, we say we're calling it Hurricane Harvey, and we're saying all the damages from a hurricane, but... Hurricane didn't come. Only the tsunami rain came. It sent a present instead of coming. It sent like a friend. And that was the flood. Mm-hmm. And so who's responsible? Who pays? Who should you call? And so I think it's important to remember that these are different types of insurance. Your homeowner's insurance is one type of insurance.
Which does not have an automatic flood insurance coverage or policy within it. That can be something completely different, which I think homeowners and business owners are now kind of in a frenzy about and kind of realizing that difference a little bit too late.
Yeah. So, we're here for you. We're going to give you a little bit of teaser on what the different insurances are. Because homeowners insurance covers you for normal things, wear and tear, things like fire, things like burglary.
Well, say theft,
But flood insurance... is different, as well as wind insurance when there's damage from winds. So flood insurance comes from rising waters, which is what we had. So we're blaming it on Hurricane Harvey, but we should maybe call it tropical storm, big mean flood Harvey.
Yeah.
Flood Harvey?
Big mean flood.
Yeah. Okay. So that's really what most of the damages I think Houstonians will face is from that.
However, Corey, tell me this. If you have damage to your roof, it's from the rain and the storm, but that's not rising water, so...
That should be your homeowner's policy. Unless it's wind. Unless they can prove, like, if the wind knocked off all your roof, and then it rained because you didn't have a roof anymore, then that's where it gets fishy and tricky, and you should definitely... Now is the time to make real friendly with your insurance agency, and they're going to be overwhelmed. Your insurance agent is going to be overwhelmed. I'm sure they're getting a lot of calls for people who have a lot of concerns. But you need to try to make some time with them and understand what your policy gives you. But what's mandated for most insurances, for most mortgage companies, if you have a mortgage, is that if you are in a flood zone, which is mapped.
Right. You will know if you're in a flood zone or not when you purchase the property.
Yeah, and they'll determine if you need flood insurance. And so if you don't, most people don't even know to go out and inquire and get their own, if their mortgage company is making it a part of it. So if you're in a flood zone, then your flood insurance is technically who you should call to discuss some of these problems.
And one thing that you've mentioned, Corey, is making good friends with your personal representative and insurance agent. Kind of going back a little bit to Bill 1774, it also changed the ability to be able to sue that personal representative. Because in the past, let's say that agent, it wasn't so much the big insurance company that was slow to respond. it was that specific representative or agent that was not pushing or processing your paperwork through. And so in the past, you could sue both that agent and the insurance company. But with a bill, you can no longer sue that agent or representative. You can only sue the big insurance company.
Yeah. So I think the process that most people will go through is you're going to contact your insurance company. And I think even to file a claim with FEMA, you have to file a claim with your insurance. Mm-hmm. But once you do that, you know, make sure you have everything that's well documented. Everything that you're claiming, you'll have to document and write down and say, I want this, I want that, this is what's missing, this is what I had.
And before you throw anything away, make sure that you've spoken with someone from that insurance agency, whether it's FEMA or the private company, to determine if you can throw anything away and what their specific guidelines are for determining what the damage is. Because some people some companies may require you to keep something so that they can come and send an adjuster to assess it in person.
Yeah.
So if you've thrown things away and just have a picture of it, that may not be sufficient enough. So make sure that you talk to the insurance company before you throw anything away or anything like that.
And that's one of those things, is no dumb questions, but you want to ask someone who's really knowledgeable. This is not something that you trust off of, I read this IG post and it says I could do that.
No assumptions.
So just make sure, you know, you're being cautious, because we do want people to really be able to rebuild. And a lot of times, you know, you have your whole life in your house.
Yeah.
And so to lose it, you know, our hearts go out to those people, but we certainly want to prepare for rebuilding.
Yes.
So, after you start the filing of the claim, you can do a preliminary bid. And from what I understand, they advise you just do some temporary fixes. Like, don't go and pay a contractor to fix your whole house until they approve the amount of your claim.
Right.
So everybody can be on the same page and you can feel assured that they're going to pay back. And the other part of that, or not pay back, pay for it.
Right.
You want the money. You know what I mean? You want your check. But just also be aware that sometimes those checks come to you and your mortgage company, because like it or not, until you pay off your mortgage, y'all own that house together. Y'all together. So making sure that you talk to your mortgage company. How do they want those claims paid, those checks paid? Do they only want you to give your contractor so much and then they release the other check? So, and it's question time. It's question time, and if you haven't been through a flood previously, it's real question time. You really want to know what your policy is. And at the end of the day, you know, if you need to assess and say, my policy did not cover me the way I wanted to, and I need to get a new policy, or I'll recheck it. But I think a lot of people are going to have to, unfortunately, jump into this wasn't right, and fight a hard fight. It's a hard fight. Insurance companies are big. And, you know, nothing happens in the time frame you want it to happen.
Right. However, we will have resources on our site, on our website for you, whether it's regarding insurance, what type of policies. We don't necessarily do these type of claims, but we will definitely have resources and be able to point you in the direction of someone who may be able to assist you.
Yeah. So, you know, keep fighting the fight, stay informed, but make sure you're getting information from a source and not just from the Google telephone game.
Right. Another big concern, Corey, since we have been in this flood and we've been going stir crazy, for those who've been stuck in the house or just unable to get to work, everybody's like, even though I'm like, I'm gonna get this check. Am I gonna get a check? Am I gonna get paid? I have bills to pay. What's going on? Am I still gonna have a job? I can't get to work. Can I get fired?
Is my job still open?
Right.
Going to reopen?
Right, exactly.
It can be a scary, very uncertain time. So let's talk about what happens to these businesses. And if you know me, you know business is my life.
Yes.
I love it. I love small businesses. And especially for small businesses, it can be a very scary time. We have been out of work. The worlds have been closed in Houston all week. Mm-hmm. They're just now reopening. And so most businesses are still closed.
Yes.
And, trying to prepare for what to do next. So that time frame can be devastating to a small business, being without income for the set amount of days, and then having employees and a staff that still want and deserve a paycheck. So that's just to happen to what happens right now. Like, if you get paid weekly, bi-weekly,
exempt,
it's Friday, I want my money too. You're calling your boss. Hey, your house flood. No, okay, where's my money? I got got people looking. I know they're looking at me. They check for me. Yeah. So let's just talk about it. What does did your employee have a responsibility to pay you this for this blood time? And the answer is, like most things legally, like it depends.
It does.
Mm. They have to pay you what you've already worked.
Yes, so that is for sure.
The time that you worked, if your payday is coming up on Friday, you get paid at the end of the month. Oh, it's at the end of the month, too. Everybody should get paid on
everybody
Friday.
Check on
everybody
Friday.
Should be getting a check. Yay, check.
Friday or Thursday. one of them.
Money's coming. You think you want it to come. So everybody, they're still required to you to pay any hours you work.
Yes.
The question becomes, office has been closed. Yes. My job is now closed. Mm-hmm. Do I get paid?
So if you're an exempt employee, then yes, you do get paid if you're an exempt employee. And let's say the office is open. So if you get paid, you get paid for the time that the office was closed. Now let's say the office is back open, but you, due to road blockages, you're flooded in, you may not have a car, whatever the case, you cannot get to the office once it's back open.
I want to correct you.
Okay.
And we'll this is going to be a point of clarification. We'll clear it up on our website. Because I don't think they have to pay you for the hours you worked.
An exempt employee? I'm sorry. You are so right.
That's why we a team.
That was right.
Why we a team?
Back up.
Rewind. Ignore what she just said.
That was for a non-exempt employee.
Yeah, okay.
I'm sorry. Let's back this train up. Okay. If you are non-exempt, meaning you do not get paid for overtime, you are entitled to your regular salary paycheck.
People.
Right. Salary, you're entitled to your paycheck if you were not able, because the office was closed, to work.
Yes.
Now, if the office opens,
everybody
else cannot get there.
Hourly.
No. Still, if you're non-exempt and you couldn't get to work, your employer can then require you to use that time as personal time. If the office is open, but you cannot get there due to personal reasons. Now, your employer may treat this differently, but the Department of Labor does enable them to make you take personal time.
Yeah, they do not have to. So, the key is, ding, ding, ding. They do not have to pay you if they were open and because of the flood, you could not make it. So, be mindful of that. Mm-hmm.
Hey, y'all.
Oh, we're going to have a fight.
if they're open
and you can't make it, they don't have to pay you.
If I'm a salary employee.
Okay, but you move to non-exempt. Okay, look. If you are an hourly employee.
Let's talk about them.
And you cannot make it to work. And your job is open. Then they may require you to take sick time, but they do not have to just automatically pay you.
No. Hourly employees, no.
So stop trying to talk about you. That's what most people
know. No, most people
are salary. What do y'all want to know? Most people are not salary. Girl, bye. That's going to be the next poll. Most people salary.
That's a good one. That's a good one.
You have to be management to be that salary.
That's a good one.
No. Yeah. But either way, if you care. So, let's just wrap this up. If you are salary.
You get your paycheck.
You get your paycheck. Yay.
You don't miss any dollars.
If you are not salaried, they are open and you cannot work. They don't have to pay you. They may allow you to use your other time, your personal time, sick time, PTO, whatever. But also, if they are closed.
Right, that's what I'm going to ask you. What about that?
If they're closed, you couldn't get there. You can or cannot get there. But if they're closed, they don't have to pay you. That is the truth. We agree on that.
We do.
They do not have to pay you if your office is closed, if it's flooded. So, you know, that is the time where they may be, you may be able to file a claim with FEMA.
Right.
You also can file unemployment with the state.
Yes.
So, there are other resources. But your job may not be one of them. And you may think about it like this. If you work for a small business, like I work for, if they're not seeing clients or taking in the, clients and payments, then they may not have the money to
pay. Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. And that's a good point, Corey, and just talking about the sustainability for small businesses going forward who may not have the money to regroup and fix fixtures, replace equipment, mm-hmm. and inventory, their physical structure, where their offices are located. And that's something that's going to be scary for a lot of business owners. But it is endurable. It's going to be a hard journey, but it is endurable.
Well, and then they also may have some business loss insurance with the insurance for your business. So if you are a small business owner and you're concerned, I've been closed, how am I going to pay for the repairs of my employees?
Right.
Then you can also check your insurance policy and see if there's business risk. And if you are due any funds for the time that you were closed due to this natural disaster. So you do want to check that resource too.
I also saw that SBA has a grant that they give to small businesses in the event of a disaster. So we'll have those resources on our site, but also just do your due diligence in researching resources that are available to you as an individual who suffered loss and also as a business who suffered loss. And one other article that I read that was kind of interesting was talking about your clientele. We think about just the business itself, but if you're out for a certain amount of time, how do you retain that clientele if there's a competitor out there that may be open? Mm-hmm. So just being creative and thinking about that and reaching out to not just resources financially, but other people who can add a benefit to your team that you may not have connected with before. We've really collaborated on the home front with regards to helping each other individually. So let's also collaborate with making sure that Houston continues to thrive as a city that's really growing with the number of small businesses and just businesses, period, that are booming down here. Let's keep that rocket ship going.
Yeah, and I will mention, this will be a minor plug, but I do have a nonprofit myself called Dreampreneur.
Yes,
and
it's really cool.
Dreampreneur.org, and we will also be having grants for small businesses. So if you want to donate to a small business or just making sure that a small business stays alive, mm-hmm. or if you're a small business and you are in need of funds, I can't say it's going to be a lot of money, y'all. It's going to be some money, though. Some is better than none.
They're marketing jobs.
I read an alarming fact. The grant came about because I read a fact that 40%, according to FEMA, 40% of the businesses that closed in the natural disaster have more than 3 feet of standing water, never reopened. That is a scary, scary fact.
That's
it has a
large,
big, long-term impact to a city like as big as Houston, because that means employees aren't going back to work, money's out of the economy. So we want to get these small businesses up and running. There is some strong short-term need with making sure people have supplies, but in the long term, we want to make sure our city continues to thrive. So you can check out those resources. You know what else, though? Not everybody's trying to do good. A lot of people are, but not everybody.
Man.
I mean, there's $30 water.
$30
water.
I'm gonna blast 24-hour fitness on Richmond, right between Post Oak and Sage. They had a case of water for $30. That is ridiculous, and it is illegal. I was rushing out to not get stuck in the flood because I shouldn't have been at the gym on Friday night. But I was trying to hurry up and get home. I did not take a picture. But if you do see any price gouging, please take a picture. If you purchase it, keep the receipts, because that is illegal, and you can file a claim against that business.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
Taking advantage of people when they're scared and they're trying to just take care of their family. But definitely the water was out. The line around the grocery stores were long.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it's certainly a time where people are stepping out and being neighborly and saying, hey, I don't have this. Do you have that? Let's have this.
Right.
Neighborhood barbecue.
Yeah. Right.
So, again, we applaud Houstonians, but if you see it, call it out.
Yes. And not just call it out on social media, but like I say, we'll have up on our website the step that you would take to report that business, because that is illegal, and they need to be
something. Somebody got to check them.
That is ridiculous. And that is not right to do that in a time when people are in need. If, let's say, you didn't have access to your money at the time, there are people who had to run out of their homes, left debit cards, had no cash on them, and you're charging water for $30.
That was normally, what do you think they normally charge for that water?
At the most, maybe like $6.
Wrong. We give you 2 thumbs down for that. So,
and if I had more hands, you would got that.
Okay, so, but they're not the only ones.
No.
A lot of people are trying to take advantage of.
And hotels.
You know, I talked about my nonprofit, but there are a lot of people saying, donate. Donate here, give us some money. And not all these causes are really getting money in the hands of those who need it. There have been some scandals with the American Red Cross. I'm not saying do not donate to the American Red Cross. So.
And let's clarify, Red Cross is an overarching company, but there are different Red Cross charities up under the overarching Red Cross. So I know there's been a lot of backlash regarding the Red Cross that was collecting money for Haiti. Yeah, they was out for that. But there are other chapters of Red Cross that do their due diligence in getting the money to those in need. So just make sure that you're doing your research. And of course, we'll have some of those resources on our website for you to go and check and review their donation, donation history, and see their financial report from previous years to see just how they allocated the money that was given to them.
Yeah, and if nothing else, I mean, I think some people, you just want to see a story. Like, where did my money go? How was it impacted? So sometimes it's as simple as going to the website of whoever is asking for the donation and seeing what's on there. Who are these people? So,
GoFundMe, I'm going to be honest. I hope you know the person personally to trust what they're doing with the money. I'm going to be honest. I'm kind of skeptical of giving money to a GoFundMe in a time like this just because that person could collect that money personally.
Yeah.
And you never know what you do with
it. Well, and it's not even that, because I saw a guy on the news who had a deaf son, and I did go donate to his GoFundMe.
Oh, okay, in that situation, yes.
He was on the news, and you could go to amillionsmiles.com, because I know that he had a link to this guy's GoFundMe, but...
If it's verifiable, yes. I completely agree with that.
Well, it's just that the person who starts a GoFundMe is not necessarily the recipient of the GoFundMe.
No.
So, there may be a disconnect in making sure that... the person who you intend to send the money to is getting the money.
Right.
So, you know, just
do a little homework. Do a little research.
And there are a lot of heart-wrenching stories. I read the story about a toddler who was clinging to, I'm not a crier, but she was clinging to her dead mother who got caught in rising water. And her mother died, and the Coast Guard was able to pick up the toddler, and not the mother was dead. So, I mean, there are some gut-wrenching stories out there about the floods and what has happened in Houston. And I'm certainly encouraging you to experience these stories because they're real life.
They're very real. I know, like, for me, I didn't really get a lot of damage. And so my mom was like, is this stuff really going on? Or is it the media kind of just making it worse than what it... No.
So not every part of Houston, which is a huge city, is like the size of New Jersey. It's a huge city. So not every city was impacted. Not every portion of the city was impacted, but there have been some real devastation. I think it's estimated that 40,000 homes have been destroyed and 20 people have been confirmed as dying.
And some people are still missing.
Still missing. So it's a very scary time, so we're not trying to diminish that.
At all.
We do want you to be careful with your resources so they're really getting to people who really do need it.
And that's my only concern. Because I just want to, because I know there are people out here that truly do need it, I just want to make sure that they are the ones that are getting it and it's not someone trying to take advantage of a bad situation for themselves. So please do not be hesitant in giving by any means. Please go with your heart and help others in need. We are a brother's keeper and we are blessed to bless others. But just do your homework in making sure that the people in need are going to get the money or whatever donations you are able to get, whether it's clothing, baby food, baby formula, toys for children.
Yeah.
Anything that you could think of that a person would need on a day-to-day basis, from toothpaste
to socks.
Like, it's not, like, don't think that, oh, they don't need this. No, people need everything.
Yeah.
So whatever you can give, please do.
And so, again, shout out to Houston. I mean, my city is making me so proud.
I'm not from here, but
I'm not from here, but I ain't from here. I'm from the trade. And
I live here 7 years now. Chicago is always home, but I do love Houston.
I like Chicago too, but I love Houston, my baby. My bubba. But I'm happy because we're about to, again, show these hurricanes, and not just figuratively. Although I am figuratively about to smash this hurricane. But, you know, in real life, we're going to take care of it, too. So thank you this week for joining us on Above the Bar. Make sure to tune into our website or follow us on IG.
Or Facebook.
For more updates for our delicious recipes and for any resources that you might need when it comes to making sure you're okay after Hurricane Harvey. Houston, we cheers to you. This one's for you.
Yes.
We love you. And tune in next week.
Love you guys.